Hi, I'm John Firth. I'm the author of two books on the Yukon Quest. The first one being called Yukon Quest, which is the history of the Yukon Quest from its founding up until 1998. And the most recent one is a book called One Mush, Jamaica's Dog Sled Team, which is the story of Newton Marshall, who was a dog musher from Jamaica, who became the first black man in history to run a long-distance sled dog race here in the Yukon in 2009. I was the only journalist that followed the entire first quest from start to finish. Following that, I became a member of the board, and in 1995 and 1996, I was the president of the Yukon side of the Yukon Quest International. Well, it's your typical Yukon, Alaska story. Where else do things start but in the bar? In the north, and this happened to start in a place called the Bullseye Saloon, just outside of Fairbanks. Four guys sat down at one table, and three of them were dog mushers and one of them wasn't. And Leroy Shank was one of the individuals there, and he was a veteran of the Iditarod. Willie Libb was a middle distance driver. Ron Rosser, a dentist from Fairbanks, he was also a middle distance driver. And Roger Williams, who was a co-worker of Leroy's, who didn't like dogs, actually owned cats, he was the fourth member. He had agreed to help Leroy with his team. Somewhere along the line, somebody, and nobody's really sure exactly who, somebody said, gee, this is a really nice race, I sure wish it was longer, because then we could keep on going. And that triggered a thought with Leroy. He thought, you know, I ran the Iditarod 2 years. He said, I really feel the Iditarod has moved away from its roots, which is the man and the dogs against nature, survival. You had to use one sled. You had to be very, very self-reliant. So Leroy thought, you know, it'd be nice to have an alternative. That's where Roger started to get interested in the whole thing, because as I said, he wasn't a dog musher, but Roger is an intellectual and he's a historian. He remembered a stop that he had made when he was first driving up to Alaska. And he and his wife Jocelyn stopped here in Whitehorse. They walked around, they ended up at McBride Museum. And Roger was absolutely captivated by this little museum in this city. And he suddenly realized, wow, you know, there's a real connected history between the people here in the Yukon and the people in Alaska. Because really, all those gold rushes were all interlinked, and that's basically what opened this country up. It wasn't until the following summer that Leroy and Roger went fishing. And Roger said, you know, he said, I really like the idea of the race. And Leroy said, yeah, he says, that's the alternative I'm looking for. So they decided that at that point that they were going to try to do something, try to put this race together. And the whole point of it was the Iditarod had become very professional. You could switch sleds, you could drop a large number of dogs if they were getting tired or if they were injured or sick or whatever. So they created a race where you could have to start with smaller teams, but you were only allowed to drop so many dogs over the course of it, which basically meant that those guys that might push their teams a little too hard had to actually hold back a bit because they couldn't afford to injure, they couldn't afford to tire out their dogs. They had to actually take better care of them. So it became a dog care race. All the mushers would be treated equally. Doesn't matter if you were running in first place or 50th place, you were going to be treated equally. it became all about, you know, going back to the basics of the sport. And that's where the whole Quest thing came from. And Murray Clayton, I believe, was the first musher to ever enter the race. Pecos Humphreys was the first musher to ever start the race. And Sonny Lindner was the first musher to win it. In the 84 race, the very first one, nobody in those communities had ever experienced anything like that. So they had no idea how to set up a checkpoint. So what Roger and Leroy did is they tried to leapfrog ahead of the teams to try to organize and say, okay, we need somebody who's going to check in the dogs. We need somebody who's going to be able to identify where the dogs can sleep, where they'll be nice and quiet, and we need a place to stay. The Dawson City checkpoint, for instance, was finally ready to go 10 minutes before the first musher rolled into town. That's how close sometimes it was, that they're still trying to sort out their paperwork and the guy's pulling up at the checkpoint. When I hopped off the plane in Eagle, Leroy was already on the ground. Leroy said, come on, John. He says, I'm going to put you to work. And I became part of the race because nobody knew how to organize food bags at the checkpoints. So all these food bags had been just piled into a great big heap behind one of the sheds, but they're not in any sense of order. It would take people a couple of hours to sort out, you know, get their food out. Meantime, the dogs are going hungry and, you know, the mushers are getting cold because they're not working the way they should be. So all this stuff had needed to be organized. Satellite phones were just coming in and they still weren't in the mainstream use. Northwestel actually was one of our sponsors, and we actually played with some of the first portable satellite phones. We took them up to Dawson City, and because they didn't know how far the footprint went, so they thought, well, here, we'll give the Quest this a telephone and send them up to Dawson. It was like a computer bag, and you opened it up, and there was a little antenna that you had to pop up, and the telephone, and all the wires, and the batteries, and everything like that. And I made the first phone call out of Dawson City to touch bases with somebody in Whitehurst to let them know that we had arrived and your phone is working. Over the years, these checkpoints have become very, very professional, very high tech, gone a long way from the old shortwave radios, and now we can do satellite phones so that you can talk from just about anywhere on the trail. Gone are the days when we used to say, okay, Hans has left CarMax. He'll be in Whitehorse, maybe 3 o'clock tomorrow morning. So everybody in Whitehorse would get up at 2:30 and they'd go down to the river and wait for Hans at 3 o'clock, and Hans didn't turn up until 10 o'clock the next morning. Part of the fun of the old days was that hurry up and wait and the guessing game of who was where and who was in first place. That was always the big thing, especially when you had teams running close together. You never knew who was in first place. Now you just look at the GPS and it's taken some of the mystery out of the race, but it was due to happen.
Tell me how it's going so far.
Oh, it's going really good. I'm happy with my team.
You must be tired. We won't keep you long, right? Yeah. I know you want to get some sleep.
Yeah.
But how long are you taking for a break tonight?
Probably around 5 hours.
Run us through what you would normally do. So you come into camp tonight. You come in at, tell us what you do, what your routine is.
Yeah, I put my dogs on straw.
Yeah.
I start cooking the meals for them. I take booties off and massage them and all that. When the meal is done, they get food and just get to rest, to sleep.
And then you get your own food.
Yeah.
And then And how long have you been mushing?
About 5 years.
How old are you?
24.
You started, right. And how did you start?
I got first two dogs. I was just going to go, when you have a backpack on the dogs, go out hiking and fishing and so on. And I got four dogs and started ski touring and I got the sled. So on, and then I ran a race, and that was it.
That's cool stuff. Where was that?
Norway.
In Norway?
Yeah.
And your parents? They mushing, or they never done anything like this before?
No.
So they think you're a bit crazy, or are they?
Yeah.
They do.
They support me.
They support you. Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And who organized this for you?
This is all through Camilla has organized everything, and it's through the Russian government.
Right. Interesting. Well, look, we'll let you go.
Oh.
Go and get your well-earned sleep. Okay. Oh, it was very nice to meet you. Yeah. And we'll see you again in Dawson. Right?
Okay.
See how you're getting on. Take care and good luck.
Thanks.
Cheers. Miller, we know you're tired and I know you want to get off to bed. Tell us how you got involved with and how you brought your out here.
Well, it's a very backwards way. I run online education programs centered around, in the past, they were always centered around very long dog sled expeditions.
Yeah.
And last year, Yor was connected with me through Kittil Vitan in Norway. I was looking for a new team member and Kittil wrote a highly recommended Yor.
Yeah.
And then he ended up going with me to Chukotka to run the Natasha Hope Race as part of our online education programming.
Yeah.
And also running up on the coastline of Nome. But while we were in Chukotka, this whole idea about making an online education program around Ringia and the Chukchi dog, and the importance of dog sledding and the dog sledding traditions in the Chukchi culture and throughout the whole Ringia region would be a fantastic way to get people involved and learn about the region.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
And so through all that, the Russians knew Yor and liked him, and he got along well with the people in the communities, which is an important part because it's about respect and about being able to work together cross-culturally.
Yeah.
And from my perspective, he had learned the ropes of what I do, communicating from the field, and that the mission is not getting from A to B, whether it's racing or expeditions or whatever it is you're doing, and that it's that you're actually delivering the education program that you got to do. And he did a great job, and I didn't know he was such a good racer.
No, okay. Go on, put yourself on the line. How well is he going to do? Where's he going to come?
It's still very early.
Don't sit on the fence.
No, it's early in the race. As I said, yeah. I have had very little expectations race-wise. It hasn't been my focus. But he's doing great. I mean, he's running phenomenal times, resting well,
Apart from Spot, happy. Can people go online and see where you're and yes. see the history about your yep. and you guys? Where,
you can go to racingbaringia.com.
Racing what? This is
Racing Beringia.
Okay, spell it.
R-A-C-I-N-G.
Yeah.
B-E-R-I-N-G-I-A. Now you're really like challenging my tired brain. .com.
.com.
Yeah. Or to polohusky.com.
Go to bed. You need to sleep.
I'm not going to deny it.
Thanks very much. Thanks
you're
for
welcome.
Doing it.
Right, you're
good
welcome.
Luck
hope you can use
it.
A little bit of it.
The route has fundamentally not changed a lot. There have been some changes to it. The quality of the trail, it's moved up from being a bush trail, which is where it started, to basically being a fairly well-maintained and very wide piece of trail, and faster as a result. The trail breakers have also a lot better. Back in 1983, nobody had ever broken a trail, and even in 1986, when they had snow from the day they started until they hit Lake LaBarge, they had snow, and snow fell every day through that whole race. And the rule was that at that time was that there would be no trail breakers preceding the sleds. So if it was snowing, that's what you had to put up with, right? But it was the slowest race ever run. And it was after that they changed the rule that trail breakers could precede the teams. From Eagle over to Dawson, it used to be all on the river. Now they bring it up over American Summit. And so that makes a pretty significant change, because American Summit is a pretty significant summit. And it's very wind-blown, and you can get some really nasty conditions up there. Here in Whitehorse, or the Yukon Inn, we've had much more significant changes in the trail. In 1996, I got a call from Teddy Charlie in Pelly, and he said to me, we'd like the Quest to come through Pelly. And I said, well, Teddy, you know, we looked at that the last couple of years and we haven't been able to identify a trail. And he says, oh, well, there's one now. And it was just he and his buddies deciding that they were going to join the Quest up. They went out and cut the trail before they even talked to us about it, because they figured that would be what they would hear. That's what they did here. The other major change that we had was that teams used to travel on Lake LaBarge. They used to go down and then travel the entire length of it, and the dogs would get really bored, because that's a 30-mile slog of just flat ice, and the dogs got really bored on it. So we changed the trail, took it over towards Tikini Hot Springs. Then in 1995, we decided that we were going to run it on the old Dawson Whitehorse Stage Road, which then brought Braeburn into the picture. That was an interesting experience, because that was all during the what I call the Cold Wars. Between the Alaskan and the Yukon boards, there was a lot of political fireworks going on over those years. And so every time you tried to make any kind of a change, somebody would explode and they'd react and overreact. And it was a pretty sensitive era. For about 10 years there was a really, really ragged relationship between the two sides. It's much better now, and it was better in the early years. It just went, but I guess it had to go through that maturing process, and that was all part of it.
Okay, Lance and Alan, you came in yesterday so strong. Tell us your story so far. I mean, Alan, if you fire off to start, how was it?
Our story from start to now?
Yeah, from start to now, yeah.
Well, you know, we try not to go too fast too early.
Yeah.
Hopefully we can just have some good healthy dogs is probably the main objective of getting here. If we can do that, then the second half is going to be a lot easier. Unbeknownst to me, I didn't know Lance was not here first. And
you didn't know?
I did not know it at all. I could not believe he wasn't here. Although he was up at this cabin talking to me, and I saw this person up there, and I said, man, he has the figure like Lance, you know, because he's way up there on the hill. No, that well, could not be. He's got to be gone.
Slim and beautiful.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Had that twinkle. Yeah. But sure enough, he was there. But,
yeah. And Lance, did you know the standings at the time? Did you?
Oh, yeah. No, I knew exactly.
He knew
I'd seen him. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's part of our job, is to pay attention to our competitors and what's going on. Can't always figure them out and know what they're doing exactly. But we had just spent close to, I don't know, an hour and a half, 2 hours together at the 40-mile bridge.
Yeah.
And
we was having a party.
Yeah, so I knew about what was going to happen. But we're all driving our teams according to what we think is right. I have a very young dog team, and
They're all new, is that right?
Most of them, not all of them, but yeah, 9 out of 10 are new. So yeah. They've never seen this trail. They've never, five of them just turned 2 years old in December. It's a very young team to go hot rodding. You know, we've already been hot rodding up to this point with 10-hour runs and 2 and 3 hour breaks. If I want a dog team at the finish line, I got to run them accordingly. So when I got to the 40-mile, the cabin we stayed there just prior to 40-mile, there's some friends of mine that I knew from the Kenai Peninsula. My team needed a rest, a little longer than an hour or two. And when I seen Alan coming, I was watching out the window basically from the time I pulled in there just to see how far he was behind. That tells me how long he stayed on his little camp spot. And when he went by, I wasn't ready to go. I still had an hour. I was adamant about staying. I'm like, well, there goes the gold, you know.
It's very tactical between you.
Well, I mean, to a degree.
Really. It's like Lance said, you're actually looking. Let the dogs dictate what you're doing. Yeah, I mean, if they're younger, then you need a little bit more rest here and there. That's what you do.
And your team of dogs?
I like to tell people I race my dogs first and my competition second. You know, if I can set myself up to be able to race at the end, great.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to race into Dawson and destroy my dog team not to be able to race at the end.
Yeah. If you have no dogs, you can't finish. So he's exactly right.
Simple as that.
And Brent, what about Brent? He set off so far. He was way ahead.
Well, I don't know. It's hard to say what he's doing, dog he has, all these things. You just don't know. We can't elaborate on what he's thinking or doing. So
we might see him at the end, not knowing exactly what he's got played out. But in past experience from me and other people, if you go out that fast, you're usually going to fall behind a little bit.
And how does this
it's 1,000 miles, not 100.
To others in terms of excitement or closeness.
Well, it's exciting racing-wise, or especially for spectators, since it's all close. I didn't know our tracker wasn't working coming in, so they didn't know who was coming in or anything. They only had Hughes that was working, so they knew where he was, and they knew we were close. That's all they knew. So that was pretty exciting for them.
Sure.
And I asked you at the bar, what are your chances? What are your chances now for the last half?
1 in 24.
Great. And Alan, yours?
Well, kind of same thing.
About 1 in 20 now, I guess.
All of us just want to stay up there close to the front. We know we can do something if we have the dogs to do it at the end. I mean, that's basically it.
Can you imagine?
Yep. Well, listen, guys, good luck.
Thanks.
Great to speak to you. And we'll see you at the other end.
Right? You certainly will. I'll be there eventually.
Yeah, thanks.
I think it's an interesting race because it tends to get into your blood. And I know some people that don't do anything more than get up in the middle of the night and go down and watch the front runners come in. And that's their only involvement to the quest, but they love it. It just gets into your blood and you start to think, wow, there's this whole romantic image of these guys out there with their dogs, and the dogs and the mushers are relying on each other, and they're striving towards a goal. And people really get caught up in that whole picture. There's only 2 long distance races in the world. That's the Iditarod and the Quest. And I think the Quest took a local race, which was the Iditarod, which although it was getting coverage in the States, nobody else in the world had ever heard of it. And the Quest, being an international race, attracted some attention. And I think it formed a cornerstone for the Yukon government, who at that time were somewhat wallowing because they knew they wanted to create a winter tourism industry here in the Yukon, but they really didn't have an anchor that they could put on the ground and say, this is what we need to do. And the Yukon Quest, I think, gave them that anchor, because then they could say, hey, we got Yukon Quest veterans here. These guys are professional mushers. Some of them are champions. We can really promote this whole idea, and we can maybe use this to grow our northern tourism industry. And in the end, that's what brought in the Fulda sponsorship. Fulda was really our first introduction into the internet world of international sports. The Fulda people were being told that the Yukon Quest was winter's Tour de France. They followed the entire quest from one end to the other, and they absolutely loved it because they all came back again the next year. So there was something about this race that catches people. Fulda, although they're no longer involved with the quest, they have stayed. But it was the quest that got them here. And it was the Quest that has formed the cornerstone of the winter tourism industry and enabled the dog mushing end of the whole thing. The Northern Lights, all of that stuff has built off of the base that the Quest created. And I don't know that the Quest plays that same role now because the industry is so much more mature than it was back in 1984. But it definitely, I think that's the legacy, is it gave the Yukon a winter tourism industry.
This year for the 30th, we have a whole bunch of events that are coming up. On Saturday, January 26th and Sunday the 27th, free mushing rides to the public. It's 11 to 3 p.m. on both days, so during the daytime, it's your time to see the dogs, touch the dogs. And the weekend of the 26th and 27th, the McBride is having an exhibit on the Yukon Quest on the 30 years of the Quest and the history of the sport of mushing. They're going to offer free admission for all kids to come in. They're also going to have a little trivia questionnaire for the kids. And the kids should keep a hold of them because we're hoping to get them to come to QuestFest during the week. And if they have all the answers right, they're going to get a free prize from the Quest. Monday the 28th up to February 1st, we have the QuestFest that starts at the Old Fire Hall right next to our offices. We're going to have presentations by Hugh Neff, who's a current champion from last year. John Firth will be around to do a bit of the history of the Quest. Karine Grenier and Marcel Frissino will be talking presentations in French about mushing. And it's just a place to convene, to meet up, ask questions, buy raffle tickets or banquet tickets. There's still some left. And we're going to be open every day. Come and ask questions. That's your chance to just touch base and who's running, any changes, what's going on. So the Wednesday, the 30th, is our Meet the Mushers. That's the free event. It's at Mount Mac. It starts at 6:30 in the evening up to 10. All the mushers will be present from both races because the mushers from the 1,000 miles will be there to sign posters and any kind of memorabilia for the public. And then the 300 mushers are there to draw their bibs and start order. So that's where we're gonna know who's gonna start first for the 300. On the 31st is our start and draw banquet. And that's where the mushers of the main race will be drawing their bibs for their start order. The tickets are $75. We still have them available here in the office. We're gonna have a sign and auction to raise money for the race. A whole buffet served by the High Country Inn. And we have another little surprise for the banquet planned, and I'm not going to reveal that right away. You should come to the banquet to see that. And then, of course, the start of the race, Saturday the 2nd. The main race starts at 11 a.m., and then the 300 race will start at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. But come on down around 8 o'clock. All the dog trucks will be around, and that's your chance to come into the dog yard and spend some time and see the dogs and the mushers. For security reason, we will be closing the dog yard around 10 a.m., just an hour before the race, because we need to make sure that there's no public around. When the teams are shooting to get into the start line, it can be dangerous. Those dogs are hyper and they want to get running. And so come early. If you want to walk around and meet the mushers, come early and you're going to get your chance for sure. Look at our website. We have the live tracking that follows every single musher on the trail. So you can see the speed they're going, where they're stopping, and who's first. Our offices will be open during the race. We're going to have somebody here to answer your questions. Stop by and say hi. These are volunteers helping us out. They'll be happy to chat and let you know what's going on with our race. Bye.